Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us again today. I'm Maia Jasper White, the Director of Chamber Music here at Caltech. Kind of a medium-length program today, so I'm going to keep the talking pretty short. The first piece on the program has some students in it who I don't know that any of them have had the benefit of ever playing in Dabney before, even though none of them are first years because of COVID. So it's kind of nice to be able to do this again and give these students the opportunity to perform in such a nice space. So please welcome them to the stage to play some Dvorak.
Freshman. from Boston, Massachusetts.
Hi, my name is Chen Ye Go. I'm from Singapore, and I'm a graduate student in mechanical engineering.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adan. I'm a postdoc at Applied Physics and Material Science Department. I'm from Ukraine, and I'm working in quantum physics.
a lot of talking today, but this piece has one of the coolest stories in the repertoire. Beethoven wrote this sonata originally. It's called the Kreutzer Sonata, but the original dedicatee was actually a very well-known black violinist at the time named George Bridgetower. And at the premiere, it was essentially a candlelight sight reading party. Can you imagine in, you know, 18 whatever, early 19th century, candlelight, Beethoven's chicken scratch, their sight reading. The piece you're going to hear, it's fiendishly hard. In fact, the dedicatee now, Kreutzer, refused to play it. He never did. And the reason that Bridgetower's name was erased from the manuscript was that he and Beethoven had a falling out over women. But the original manuscript also said, to my lunatic mulatto friend. Strange, right? So that's the story. Now you know who George Bridgetower is and that it should actually be called the Bridgetower Sonata. But it's an extremely cool piece. So much rock and roll. Please enjoy. employed by Caltech, I probably know the fewest formulas, but there is one that I coined, I think, that I'm particularly proud of, which is genius equals craft plus inspiration. And although composers like Beethoven and Brahms and Bach get all the love as far as German heavy hitters go, Schumann really exemplified both of those things. In fact, he sort of had a dual career as a music theorist. The piano quartet that you're about to hear is such a perfect example of his genius because not only are there these sublimely beautiful melodies with really surprising, colorful harmonic changes, but the way that the entire piece is structured is pretty miraculous. So in the first movement, he does this thing that I think is really cool and that you don't really see fully developed until much later with composers like Mahler, which is called developing variation. So you get to hear something, and then it's intercut by something else, and then you go back to the thing you heard before, but it's somehow informed by the thing you just heard. And that kind of thing, it's a very iterative kind of writing, and it's very sophisticated and very intuitive at the same time. But if you're paying attention, you'll really notice that. And that same kind of thing happens in a larger way in the second movement as well. It's the scherzo that's intercut by two different trios. So just notice how you hear the scherzo differently after each trio that you've heard. The third movement is like sheer romance. Watch Joe, the cellist, because he has this really cool effect where he gets to tune down his lowest string and then tune it back up just in time. But it gives this really kind of otherworldly color. Anytime you change the natural tuning of the instrument, the color changes a lot because the resonance does. The last movement is both a fugue and a rondo. For those of you who don't know what those two things mean, a rondo is kind of like a club sandwich where you have bread, turkey, bacon, bread, you know, bread, tomato, bread, lettuce, bread, mayonnaise, that kind of thing. So the rondo theme is the bread. And again, every time you hear the rondo theme, you hear it a little differently because of what came in between, whether it was bacon, tomato, or what have you. So a fugue means it's a very, very complex idea, but it's essentially that each player plays the same thing one after the other, and there's this kind of counter melody going on underneath. So in the last movement, it's both, and he takes little nuggets from each of the previous three movements and manages to incorporate them in the last movement also. So, poof, amazing piece. Please enjoy.
Fourth year in chemistry grad student.
pianos. Some Tchaikovsky from the Nutcracker. And a special surprise.